lady on the couch next to me is a producer, a DJ, but she's best known for running two of the most interesting and influential labels in her world. Please help me welcome Veronica Vasicka.
Thank you, thank you.
Now, we asked you to bring some records and we ended up having like a living room's worth of records, so we've got so much music to get through today. But I'd like to start at the very beginning. Okay, complete the sentence for me. Eighth grade would not be the same if...
If Veronica wore white. How do you know that one?
I'm pulling a Nardwar on you, we're in Canada. Why would eighth grade not be the same if Veronica wore white?
Well, that was actually from my yearbook, as you probably imagined. That was when I started getting into really weird underground electronic music. It was around eighth grade.
And how old would you have been in eighth grade?
14. Yeah.
And where was 14-year-old Veronica listening to this stuff?
I started listening to a lot of weird stuff on the radio. And I made mixtapes when I was around 11, started making mixtapes and giving them to friends and doing the artwork for the tapes, making collages. And then by the time I was 14, 15, I was going to clubs in New York City, just sneaking out of the house and, yeah, going wild at the clubs.
So where would a 14-year-old Veronica go in New York City? It was mostly downtown, right? There were pretty important clubs for this kind of weird music downtown.
Yeah, it was the Pyramid Club, which actually still exists on Avenue A in the East Village. And then the Limelight. Mm-hmm. And actually at the Limelight, I saw a lot of industrial bands from Europe that came in and played shows. I mean, I didn't even know who I was seeing. Like Front 242, Nitzareb, and then there were various like warehouse parties that just had addresses but didn't have names.
What was the Limelight like? How would you describe it when you walked in? How would you describe like the trip through the Limelight?
Well, the Limelight was an old church that was converted into a club. And so when you walked in, I mean, it was like a Gothic cathedral that you were walking into. And they had a card room on the second floor, which was actually made out of like life-size playing cards. And you could walk through it. And it was really bizarre. And each room had a different theme. And then the room that I was always in was called the Chapel, and that was where Dave Kendall from the UK, who was emceeing 120 minutes, mm-hmm. MTV's 120 minutes. So I watched 120 minutes and see Dave Kendall playing all this alternative and indie rock and new wave music, and then I would see him DJ on Tuesday nights, you know, in the flesh. I mean, I didn't think he wasn't really an idol, but I just thought it was like amazing to be able to go hear him play.
So you would watch this stuff on MTV and then also be able to go to the club when it was happening.
With a fake ID.
We're doing things properly around here. What was it like to watch something subcultural on TV, on MTV, and then be able to just go to the club that it was happening in? Was that quite strange?
Well, I didn't have a reference point to what wasn't strange or, you know, the fact that other people couldn't really do that. Mm-hmm. So to me, it was like my own little world of music that was an escape from, you know, going to school. I mean, I did go to school, but I kind of didn't enjoy hanging out with people at school. So also, I met other people outside of that.
Also in the Limelight, that was, I'm wondering about the influence that somewhere like the Limelight might have had on you, because it was very like a multimedia club, wasn't it? They had like a room dedicated to the guy who designed all the stuff for Alien, all mm-hmm. the influential stuff like that, H.R. Geiger. Can you explain like what that looked like?
I mean, it really looked like a movie set. I mean, each room had... was kind of cavernous, and there were all these little tiny rooms, which, you know, were central to the architecture of the fact that it was, that had been a church. So it was, yeah, it was ultimately really fascinating. And then, of course, they would have smoke machines and all kinds of bizarre lighting and strobes and, you know, different kinds of music in each room. So,
actually, for an example of that sort of music, I'd like to play a video by a group called Front 242 that you just mentioned. And you saw these guys play live there, right? Yeah. I think it would be really great to watch this video and get a sense of what this sound was in this club and what kind of instruments they were playing for this kind of electronic music. So if we could have that video, that would be great, please.
So cool.
Very cool.
There's so much going on in a group like Front 242, but in that particular video, can you describe kind of what they were playing and the sounds that they were using in there? Because this was released in 1984, which is roughly the introduction of MIDI as a sound. Yeah. So if you could kind of explain what interests you as that band and the kind of sounds that you were hearing when you were dancing around to this stuff.
Very early industrial. I mean, industrial music spanned a long period, but that early sound is, to me, it's like the most attractive of the range of industrial music. They had electronic drums and synthesizers. I know they had a Juno 60, a Roland Juno 60, and I mean, I don't know what kind of drum samples they had in their electronic drums, but that performative aspect of just like being able to play, you know, a setup that is very easy to transport was like super attractive to me and still is. You know, they didn't need to have a full band. So yeah, really cool.
And how would you describe the aesthetics and mood of this kind of music? Because I think when you look at artists like that, you think of elements of like pop, but also goth and industrial. It's like, how would you describe the mood and the fashion of this particular thing? Because that's just one music video to express an entire sound. It doesn't quite get into the whole thing. So if you could develop upon that.
Yeah, I would say, I mean, there's something, of course, like militant about it. And then just actually something like really sexy about it too. So it's this hard to explain.
It has a sense of humor to it, doesn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, they're having fun. Like, you can see that they're having fun and they're totally into what they're doing. But as far as, yeah, I don't know how I would describe more than that.
But all those things were attractive to you as a teenager listening to that?
Yeah. Yeah, I didn't even know why. Like, I just loved that kind of sound. I mean, it was obviously like after listening to rock and like classic new wave, it was a departure from that, which I found really interesting, because they weren't trying to sound like, you know, a big studio band. They were just pretty primitive and purely electronic, which I liked.
There's also, that was from the mid-80s, but the pop element of it is really important, I think, into what you do with your work. I'd like to play another track just off myself. Unfortunately, one of the many vinyl we have it here. I'm just going to play like a sad and lonely MP3. It looks so terrible in comparison.
Have that record.
No, it's actually a different one. I'm going to play one from about nearly 10 years before that one, just to show like the breadth of how embedded like synthesis kind of music is in pop music. This is by a group called Ultravox, and this came out in 1977, and I think it sounds like techno.
Yeah.
And it's dope. Are you a fan of Ultravox?
Yeah, of
course. Okay, well, great, we got that then. That's done. Okay, this is Ultravox, Mr. X. I hope this works. I think it's very easy for us to talk about music sounding weird, but weird is not necessarily the preserve of just the underground at the time. Like, things sift back and forth, and I think that's a particularly fertile sound to go between, like, underground music and pop music. So were you listening to stuff like that when you were growing up as well, as well as going to, like, the Limelight?
Yeah, I mean, I would say that stuff came a little bit later, actually, because, I mean, I grew up in New York, and I was listening to slightly later stuff from the new wave sound and new wave scene. But I'm thinking that actually Ultravox had influenced a lot of the bands on minimal wave on my label. And you can hear that direct link. And actually was thinking to play Modern, which was a band from France who were produced by Joshko Rudas, who produced Kraftwerk's Man Machine. And you can hear that production quality, which is actually really similar to what we just heard in that Ultravox record. So should we hear one of the tracks off of this record?
So this is the first of many. We're probably going to end up playing this afternoon. So this came out in minimal wave.
That's so good. Yes. Thanks. So yeah, that was an example of, like, really impeccable production quality that came out on
I'll
on
be
my
your
label,
assistant, don't worry.
It's not exemplary of all of minimal wave releases, because a lot of them are very DIY, and they were recorded in home studios. This one, they happen to have to up the production value. So, yeah, it's a special one.
Let's get into your long back catalogue and how it started to happen. The minimal wave aesthetic is really interesting because it's a combination of what you've called the cold wave and the minimal synth sounds. Can you explain what those are and where they come from?
The minimal synth sound is, it was basically artists that were making music at home with drum machines and synthesizers and just recording everything on 4-track recorders and in a very DIY fashion, where lots of times it was just one artist, in his lonely home studio bedroom recording songs. And cold wave was more guitar oriented. It was what was happening in France as a response to post-punk and music that was happening in Belgium and the UK. So when I started the label in 2005, it was just about the passion that I had for both of those types of music and how I saw a lot of overlap between those two genres, which were very, like, particular genres. And I guess because there were a lot of compilations that came out that had cold wave bands as well as minimal synth bands, there wasn't a strict delineation between the two. So there's also a guy in Canada who, his name was Alex Douglas, and he started a contact list of electronic music. And basically it was a zine that had addresses and contact information for artists from all over the world. So through that, artists could collaborate, and they wrote to each other and they sent tapes through the mail. And that was ultimately really fascinating to me when I discovered a lot of this music on cassette that were results of collaborations from, say, an artist in New York and an artist in Belgium. And maybe we could go right into that and play one of those tracks. It's called The Hidden Tapes, the compilation. I don't know if you have it over there. Let me take a look. Let me see if I can find it.
It has a girl's face.
Is that the one with Aurora Halal's face on it? Okay.
Yeah.
Got a few Aurora Halal fans in the house. So you kind of got devoted to putting out compilations through finding compilations yourself, and we'll probably get into how you managed to find this stuff, but this is, what track is this? So
this is, it's called Like I Am. Oh wait, no, this is not Like I Am, Comme Je Suis. It's Microphone Connection. And yeah. This is an artist from Belgium called Univisual, and in collaboration with an artist from New York called Tara Cross, who is now a hairdresser.
Hello, Hank. Remember me?
Okay, so that one is really cool.
Now, the illustration of that record that you just gave us there is a really brief introduction into your quite slavish process and how you've built this label up, finding inventories of people's contact details through mailing lists and cassette tape, linear notes and all this kind of thing. Can you talk about why you would do that? I know that sounds like such a simple question, but if you can go hear the kind of the front 242 sounds in a big club in New York when you're younger, and you can buy front 242 tracks on Wax Tracks and other big labels, why go in that archival search to find something so strange? Like, some of the releases I know have been out on one 200 cassette tape run in 1982, and you found them, released the record, got their permission, and you've done it close to 100 times and not including the compilations. So why would you do that?
Well, I mean, it's interest really in the music, and obviously feeling an affinity to those artists and feeling some kind of similarity. I mean, I was recording music myself from when I was 14, 15 on by myself, just really as a diary and not for public consumption, just to make music. And I think when I heard this, especially that last track we heard, I just felt identified with that and kind of this private world of music. Here she is, you know, telling him, here's a track I made for you, and curious to hear what you think. And, you know, and they're doing this literally transatlantic collaboration, which I just found really fascinating. I had, in a way, been keeping my own diary of recording my own music onto four-track recorders. When I was about 17, 16, I discovered Throbbing Gristle, and I was very influenced by them. They were doing performance art. I mean, they blurred the lines between what was music and what was performance, and kind of causing people to lose their expectations, not knowing, you know, going to a show and not knowing what kind of performance was going to ensue. That was really interesting to me. So I think Minimal Wave was the culmination of those influences.
I think the aesthetic, as you say, of Throbbing Gristle and all these other bands is really interesting, because you are very, very involved in the design of everything. And you went to the Rhode Island School of Design, right?
Mm-hmm.
To study photography.
Yeah.
What were the dominant design trends of the day? Like, what was the aesthetic of that time like for you?
You mean when I was studying, or?
What was the design of everything around you like? What was advertising like? What was fashion like? And what were you doing at the photography that was something completely of your own?
It was the 90s, and the Face magazine from the UK was a big inspiration. I loved the design of that magazine. But when I was in school, I wasn't doing any graphic design. I was just doing a lot of black and white photography and some color as well. I don't think it really had to do with what was happening at school, my interest. I think it had to do with looking at old records and just collecting stuff from the early 80s. And like that vinyl magazine, there was a magazine out of the Netherlands that was designed by Max Kisman, and he designed all the typography and the fonts for his music magazine. And I just, to me, that was like very inspiring. He did every aspect of the magazine, aside from being a music fanatic. So actually this, the font that's used here in the hidden tapes, that is from Vinyl Magazine. And I'm trying to find the other one. The first time that I used that font was over here for the Lost Tapes.
We actually have a scroll of pictures of all the different artwork and influence as well, if we could get that up as like some visual candy. Yes, this is a bunch of your artwork, and there'll be some of the magazine in with that so people can get a feel of it. But was drawing from zines and ideas of design and photography, that fell into how you managed, how you run the label, because you would design the records as you were listening to the music, right?
Yeah,
Could you talk about your process a little bit? Because that whole DIY way of doing things is something that people find very familiar and would like to get involved in, and they think about a lot.
Well, maybe we can talk about the Lost Tapes, because this is the first compilation that I put out, the Lost Tapes. And this was mostly European synth music from the early 80s that was like very limited, released in very limited batches. And the photograph is actually a portrait that I took of my best friend when I was 16. And I had painted my room black, so that background was my black room, and then it was like natural sunlight coming into the room.
So you painted your whole bedroom black just to take that photo?
Well, no, not just to take the photo. It was just like around that time. Like when I look at this, I remember painting my room black at that time.
That's exceptionally goth of you. Well done.
So I'm actually looking for the follow-up. There is another compilation called the Found Tapes, which was the follow-up to that. And let me find it. So this is the American side. So this is a compilation of North American synth and wave stuff. And of course I took this photo later, around the time that I was putting this record together, because I thought the European side could be the feminine side, which was already done, and then this is the masculine side, the North American side. So
why the feminine, the masculine?
I don't know. I mean, I think in my mind, I just, if I were to reference like the European synth scene or whatever was coming out, I feel it's more feminine than what was coming out of the US. I mean, we can listen to this and you can hear what I mean, sure, if you want to do that. Okay. I'm trying to figure out which track. We can play, hold on.
I feel like we're actually in your living room right now. I think this is probably what your house looks like, right? It's a sofa, yeah, loads of records everywhere.
I do have a blue velvet sofa at home.
Is this your sofa? Oh God.
It looks a little like it.
So
I don't know what to play, but because there's so many different tracks. But,
what's the difference between Lost, Hidden, and Found? Like, what's the lineage of that?
Play Iron Curtain. Lost Tapes and Found Tapes? Mm-hmm.
What's the lineage? You've got Lost, there's Hidden, and Found for all the
lost,
tapes.
Yeah, there's Lost, Hidden, Found.
Well, what's why name them, though, that way?
Just, well, initially I didn't know that I was releasing the Found Tapes later, but, you know, the Lost Tapes were like lost tapes that had resurfaced. And the Found is just, you know, another version of Lost. It's just Found tapes.
Okay.
There's nothing deep to it, really.
It's not that deep.
No, it's not that deep. I mean, I like those titles. I don't know how else to get into that. But I don't know if you want to hear this like synth punk band from Florida or this band from the West Coast called Iron Curtain. But I mean, you'll see what I mean. This is like more masculine sounding.
I really enjoyed what you were saying about the romance of and the sincerity of finding a lost recording from somebody, you know, wrote basically a love letter or a note or wrote a piece of music as to how they felt, like posted it to someone and you found it. Could we possibly go a little bit back to how you actually do this as like a daily like operation? Like, where do you do it? How do you do it? Where do you find this music? If it's so lost and hidden, like where do you go and find it? You know?
Well, I mean, it starts with collecting cassettes, which I'd been doing for a long time. And just collecting obscure records, going to record fairs, zines like Vinyl, the one that you see up there. There were a lot of articles about obscure bands in that magazine. And then looking up addresses that were, say, on the back of an album and just writing letters and trying to find the people behind those limited edition releases. So, yeah, that's where it starts.
And it is it as much of the story as the music as the people that you find? Because I know that the first record you ever put out was by a nuclear scientist. Is that
right? Yeah, he's a nuclear weapons expert. Andy Oppenheimer, and he is he lives in the UK in Brighton.
So how did you get in touch with a nuclear weapons expert?
I wrote to his, he was working for a consulting firm, and I wrote to them, and then at first he was, how did you find me and how do you know about my music? And he was like, he was kind of afraid about, I mean, because he's trying to live a different life now. And he was really freaked out. But then over time, I had a conversation. You know, I was emailing and calling him. And we were talking on the phone. And his musical partner, who ended up becoming a doctor, just a GP, he in the UK as well, he was really interested in having all the music out there, in having those archives. So he's the one that ended up, Martin Lloyd, ended up going into the archives and transferring everything digitally. The process with analog tape is that the tapes needed to be baked before they were transferred. Baked in a low temperature oven.
How do you bake a tape? Like, if I wanted to bake a tape, could I bake a tape?
Well, you need to know how to do it so that your tape doesn't fall apart. But what happens is the magnetic particles over time in the tape can just, like, completely decompose. And if you're transferring the tape and it hasn't been baked, then through the process of transferring, it could just fall apart. So baking the tape makes it resilient for that transfer. So you have about like 3 to 5 days to transfer that tape digitally before it, like,
before it's actually lost.
Well, it might not sound good anymore. It might sound warped. It actually ends up sounding better in a lot of cases than the original recording, which is really interesting.
Is that a process that you employ for a lot of the records that we've been hearing, that they've been found on these tapes and you're at home baking them? One after the other.
I'm not doing the baking, but okay. I'm not the specialist in baking.
You're not the baking specialist. Okay.
I mean, I do bake cakes, but not tapes. So, yeah. But in this case, Martin did the baking, and he's a technical genius. He's no longer with us, unfortunately. He passed away. But so this is the first record I released, and this was after the whole. You know, after he transferred the tapes initially before they were baked, and there was a warbling sound, and they weren't releasable. They didn't sound good. So we talked about it and we researched and we found out that if you bake tapes, then there's a likelihood that they're going to sound better and you can transfer. I'm talking about like 30-year-old tapes. Okay. So
this is the product of the baked tape.
Yeah. So okay. This was the track that they were known for called The Devil's Dancers. Known in their small circles.
Amazing. Great. Right.
We're the Devil's Dancers.
There's so much talk about that. That was the first record you ever put out in Minimal Wave.
Yeah, this was this came out in 2005. Mm-hmm. But I just want to tell you about the meeting, about how they met Andy Oppenheimer. So these are quotes that we put in the liner notes of the re-edition. This is a most recent re-edition of their all their material. This came out last year. And so Andy Oppenheimer, I was at a publishing party at the 1979 World Science Fiction Convention in Brighton. This is how they met. I'd been trying to engage a rather tipsy pre-famed Douglas Adams, author of HHG, in conversation, as he happened to be sitting on the same sofa, when I saw Andy across the room, dressed exactly as Bowie in The Man Who Fell to Earth. I had to speak to him. So that's the context of their meeting.
So there's a guy dressed like David Bowie at a sci-fi convention.
That's Andy, yeah. That's the guy who, yeah, the singer. That's the nuclear weapons specialist. Okay. And then on the music, because basically for this release, I had asked him to answer these few questions, these basic, interesting facts, whatever. On the music was written at my home studio, Feedback Studio in London, and cassettes were sold at pub gigs. So they played at pubs, science fiction conventions, and the Bowie amateur home taping. Oh, wait. Sorry.
It jumped the line.
And the Bowie amateur home taping boom? Wait, no.
It sounds interesting.
And the Bowie convention. There was a Bowie convention where we played for our largest audience, 2,000. In all, around 200 copies were made. This was at the height of the amateur home taping boom, when Melody Maker Sounds and NME would offer free advertising and reviews in their home taping columns and wanted to appeal. Okay, that's it. And basically, they spent between £1 and £3 on advertising and NME and Melody Maker. So that
That was like the economy of how the music would get around in these small circles, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Right. Okay.
In these zines and magazines, but like many other bands on Minimal Wave, the way that Martin describes success is pretty much, I think, the outlook of most of these bands. We were never set out to be commercial in any sense. We have always wanted to appeal to those who share the same taste in music and culture. While friends encouraged us to release Devil's Dancers and Cold War on singles, this never happened as we stopped working together. Da, 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 da. I decided to limit my involvement in the music business. It wasn't about anything other than hobby, you know, getting together, playing music, recording, and doing these limited edition tapes.
On that note then, if you find these people who are nuclear scientists and doctors and they sometimes haven't talked to each other for years, haven't made music for years, and you turn up out of nowhere and go, I want to release your music, was there ever a sense you were like intruding on their lives? Like wanting to do this? Did you have people that were very resistant? Because I think possibly the idea like, oh, you found my music after so many years. I'm so grateful someone bothered to care. But there must be people out there who were like, why? Just please leave me alone.
Oh, like, yeah. There are plenty of people that don't want their music to be reissued. But a lot of times I don't go further and bother those people.
Because don't bake my tape.
It actually doesn't work. If the initial response is like, I'm not interested, then it, because I did, of course, try like certain artists that I really wanted to release. And it doesn't work. So, But I think maybe we can talk about Innate or Numbale from France, because
he was pretty keen. He was pretty keen to get his music out there, wasn't he?
Yeah.
Yeah, he was pretty good.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm wondering, just before that, I have kind of a question about your kind of like responsibility in that regard, running a label. I know it's a personal endeavor, but when this music was, you know, recorded and heard in a certain form early on, and now you've gone through the process of baking a tape, redoing the artwork yourself, representing it in this context, along with eventually a large back catalogue of other records quite like it. Do you ever think about how you may or may not be presenting it in the way that it was intended, and how much of it is about an aesthetic that you particularly enjoy and you want to find music that fits your personal tastes? Does that make sense?
Yeah, I get what you're saying.
How in control are you of other people's music when you take it away and do other things with it?
I mean, I often do several different designs and ask them which design they prefer. But I also think they were never really given the chance at the time to have an aesthetic out there per se, aside from like when they played live. So I think it's just about expanding upon what they've already created. Yeah.
And the popularity of this label, the sounds that have come from it, it's actually, you know, people use minimal wave very interestingly as almost like a genre term, which I find fascinating, because I don't really know any other labels where people do that right now, where they say, oh, it's like minimal wave, but it might be a record that's not on your label, but they use the words minimal wave to describe it. And it's actually had an impact in techno in recent years, which maybe people in the room who like techno might have heard fragments of, but all the different strands of this is actually fed back into current techno culture, right? Have you seen that yourself?
Yeah, well, I think I do a sub-label called Cititrax, and Cititrax is pretty much like new artists who have been influenced by minimal wave, and they're making dance music. They're making like mutant techno and...
A mutant techno.
Yeah, mutant techno. Yeah. Because it's not techno in the traditional sense. Mm-hmm. And yeah, I think having these influences, it just kind of shifts. If you just listen to minimal wave for, you know, an entire year and then you make a techno record, it's not going to sound like traditional techno.
It's not going to sound like Jeff Mills.
Yeah. But, I mean, we do have a record of that example.
Let's play a techno record. Let's go for it.
But I think we should start.
Oh God!
Oops. We can start with Innate or Numbale,
yeah,
and then we can go to NI, which is a Cititrax release that is a friend of mine who actually he's like a perfect example of he didn't know what he wanted to make. I knew I wanted to release something of his. And then he was asking me about that weird Belgian shit. Like he was,
what's the weird Belgian shit?
Like, you know, like early Front 242 and stuff like that. But the Liaison Dangereuse, Los Niños del Parque, do you know that track?
Yes, they actually just reissued that. This looks so complicated. Here you go.
But he was just referring to like music that I was listening to. And so I ended up sending him a bunch of stuff. And then 3 months later, he recorded this like incredible track that we ended up putting out, which I'll play in a little while.
And who's Innate or Numbale? Am I saying that right?
Yeah.
I've had conversations about how to say that right. Innate or Numbale. Okay.
Well, I mean, I say Innate or Numbale, but it's Latin and it should be in aeternam vale.
And what does it mean in Latin? Do you know?
Until the end or something like this. Until the end. It's really... So he's from Lyon and he's an artist who was making a lot of synth punk in the early 80s. Really frenetic sounding stuff. Discordant, noisy. And then over time, he started making other stuff. In 1987, he made this track that's it's just like a pure techno track. And he didn't have a context for it. He hadn't been listening to techno. So I think that's like extremely fascinating.
It's so interesting when people make techno but they don't really listen to it and it ends up sounding like techno.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, this is a 13-minute track. that track keeps going. This is a 13-minute track, so you really need to hear the whole thing because it gets heavier and heavier as it goes on.
So throughout the label, you've transitioned through 80s synth pop. You've done more cold wave stuff, post-punk. I can barely speak. I'm overwhelmed by the techno. And now we're at techno. Like, I actually maybe wanted to totally flip the script and watch a video, if we could please, of something else that you put out. And I want to kind of watch it and talk about it in the sense, kind of with ideas of what is cool and what is not, and what is pop and what is not. So could we have the video from Pas de Deux, please? And this is 1983, I believe.
The singers are two girls called...
There's a few things within that that are fascinating. This is the record of that song. This is the album that that song is on, right?
That's the album.
Thank God this is on that.
Yeah. Rendezvous's on there. Uh-huh. Rendezvous was never my favorite song. That's a song they did for the Eurovision Song Contest in 1983. That was why there was like so much production going on, because they wanted to win this song contest.
I find it so interesting when you we went from techno right to that, but I think a video like that is so interesting because contemporary ideas of what is musically and artistically of value and interesting are not always what we look back on and think are of artistic value and are interesting. And I think if you were watching Eurovision at the time, you'd be like, what is this? Like, this is rubbish. But you released it on a label in the context of like post-punk and synth pop and techno and industrial music. And I love the idea that we can look back on footage and really romanticize what's going on at certain points in history, particularly with music. We use nostalgia as an aesthetic, but actually you look back and a lot of music that was going on at that time was kind of mad, and that was on Eurovision. So can you tell me about the journey of that going from Eurovision to minimal wave?
Yes, so this band, they're a band from Belgium, and it was Walter Verdun and these two women in the band that you saw dancing in the video. And I first heard this track called Les Jumeaux in off of a cassette compilation that a guy, a collector in Germany, had made. So they had a few 7-inches in the early 80s. And amongst minimal synth collectors, it was really cool to play one of these tracks, way too slow. So I'll play that one first.
Why way too slow? Like, why was the slower cooler?
I'll show you. Yeah, we'll play it.
We had a lecture with Tim Hecker the other day, which was fascinating. And he had a line where he said that there's this malaise of the archivist. And you're an archivist. Originally, the label was started as an online archive where we were just going to upload like pictures and videos and clips and artwork and stuff. But you decided to turn it into a label. But you very much ran the label with the mindset of an archivist. Mm-hmm. Do you ever get overwhelmed by how much there is yet still to hear and to learn? And do you ever get possibly overwhelmed by the idea that you'll never, the knowledge that you'll never hear everything?
No. I feel like there is this untapped world of very similar music, other bands that were doing the same thing, not the same thing, because I don't think any of these bands are doing the same thing exactly, but I don't really feel that, because I feel in order to move forward, it's important to just do that to move forward. And like, for example, like what I was talking about Cititrax and artists that are making music today that are influenced maybe by the sounds, these old sounds. But maybe if you'd asked me that like 6 years ago, I would have answered differently. So, yeah.
Interesting. Okay. And do you think nostalgia plays a role in what you do? Are you kind of looking for something that you didn't possibly grow up with and were from different countries and that were lost and hidden and underappreciated? And this is a kind of a romantic gesture to run a label like this?
Yeah, I think nostalgia definitely plays a key role. I mean, I think a lot of these mixtapes that I was making when I was like 11, I was 11 years old and making mixtapes. I mean, I didn't even know what I was recording off the radio. But that was a really important time because it was like my escape from everything else that was going on around me. And maybe it's nostalgia for that time, you know, where I didn't have adult responsibilities. And just as a teenager, it's like everything's your own world. Everything you get into. And I was also, when I was 16, I was working at a record store and they had like bargain bins and stuff like this and stuff they couldn't sell. And so I discovered a lot of stuff through there. Yeah.
Do you think nostalgia is healthy to keep moving forward? Do you think it's a healthy thing to have as part of your work?
Not in excess, but I think to the degree that I have it, I don't think it's a problem.
It's not a problem so far. You got all this to show for it. Yeah.
Yeah.
I actually wanted, before we take questions, I kind of wanted to put somebody in the room on the spot. Hi, Marie. We've got something for you. You want to see? Yeah. It's Marie's record.
Yeah, the surprise. Marie's record. Yay.
I feel like this is like the coolest version of QVC ever. I'm like, oh, Marie.
Yeah, wait, I just want to get the insert.
So
out.
How do you know Marie?
There's Marie. So,
It gets better.
It gets better. Now, Marie's. Marie's actually never seen this, have you? You haven't seen it physically yet. So this is the first time you've seen your record. Yeah, of course, you can have it. It's yours. Go on, it's yours. There you go, have a look. Now, Marie is released on your label Cititrax, right?
Yeah, this record's coming out on Thursday.
Sick. So we have a world exclusive.
We just got the copies. Yeah, it turned out really well.
Yeah, it turned out pretty good. Yay! I would quite like to maybe end before we go to questions. Could we play Naive to the Bone?
Yeah.
Which I know you've opened your set with at festivals and in mixtapes, so I know it's a fantastic track. So well done, Marie. You did it, girl. You did it. Does anyone have any questions for Veronica? Should we start at the front? Have you got a mic for them? That'd be great.
Hello. First of all, I wanted to thank you for coming here. I've been like listening to a lot of stuff that I've never heard before, and I'm making like all these connections in my mind, like from Kraftwerk to Electrovox to like Cybertron, and then from Pas de Deux to like the rock and opposition bands, and I'm so excited. Like I can't even tell you. One thing that I've noticed, like making all these connections and stuff, is like how important I feel it is, like that these bands from all these different places, they had something in common. They had a common language that they could speak, which was like, in a way, the language of machines, and this thing that had been starting to happen all over the world, where we're living in like a mechanized time, so to speak. And I think that's the best way that globalization could go. Like that we still have our own thing, but we can have a common language to speak. So I wanted to ask you, what are your thoughts? What your thoughts on this issue, if this is something that you think about, also politically, because it's so important that we have something in common with each other, so that we don't kill each other and stuff.
Yeah, no, definitely. But your question is, where do I see? I mean, I know what you're saying. I totally agree. This is the machine music was the common language. But what is your question?
Exactly? I mean, when you're selecting your tracks, when you're thinking about music, when you're doing a DJ set, when you're doing your work as an archivist and also as a label, getting this music out into the world, if you're thinking about this kind of how do I say if it's a value to you, and how do you feel about this is hard to say, but how do you feel about the fact that these people from different parts of the world were exchanging music? They have this thing that they could speak about and that they could connect with. I don't know if I'm making sense.
Yeah, no, I find it very romantic that they had this common language and they were doing very similar things in different parts of the world, especially when it comes to the collaborative thing. I mean, I think the main difference is that we have the internet today, and so people can collaborate, through sending files to each other online. But yeah, I mean, I think it's only grown that interconnectivity between people, on a global level. It had just started musically for them through the mail by sending things through the postal service, and now it's grown exponentially, with the extremely fast file transfers and kind of, this technology in that sense has brought us all closer together.
Do you think that perhaps your work in archiving these physical formats in the best ways that you can, do you feel that there's almost a new thematic angle on it now because of the internet, and there's a sense of maybe urgency to preserve even more of the things of that common language?
Yeah, definitely. Because this was everything's kind of a slower form of artwork, even in terms of design. I mean, when I'm scanning in fonts and doing cut and paste and doing that for album covers, and then, hand numbering, a lot of these are hand numbered editions.
Yeah.
So each one is physically hand numbered. So it's just a slower process overall. And I think it's important for us to slow down because with technology, phones, internet, and everything, air travel, it's everything's super fast and maybe too fast for us as human beings, our capacities as humans. I think it's unnaturally fast. So in terms of artistic process, I mean, I get a lot from doing things in a more DIY way where I'm even recording. I mean, I do record my own stuff. Even doing it in the most primitive fashion is sometimes more comfortable. It's better.
Yeah, the physical labor of it is part of the process, right?
Yeah. And of course, having limitations is important.
Anyone else? Did you have one?
Yeah, cool.
Hi, thanks for coming.
Thanks.
I was wondering if you had any kind of practical advice for people like us who might be looking to start their own DIY bedroom labels to start documenting our own scenes and stuff.
Yeah. Well, I think first by collecting content, gathering content of what you feel is I guess, key and what you feel is most important to you and what you're passionate about. I think it's important to keep with what you're passionate about, not think about how it would be received to the world, because that never works as a starting point. And then decide your format. Like, are you going to release things just digitally, or are you going to do it? Do you want to release things on vinyl or cassette? I mean, you could do a cassette label.
You've actually got a new one here
at home, which is, you know, you could produce everything at home on your own cassette deck. And it's like, you could do mail order cassette label and nobody would know that it's just you in your bedroom doing it. Like, so yeah, I mean, I can give you practical advice depending on what, if you want to do vinyl, you could just call the pressing plants and ask for a price quote and say, I want to do like an issue of 300 copies. You may be better to do with it without label art, just to do like white labels, and you can hand stamp things. Or I saw this really good record recently that had like a holes punched through it. That was the artwork. It was just, it had this like die cut, this pattern that was like punched through it, and it looked great. So yeah, there's many different ways you could do it.
Cool. Thanks.
There's one right there.
I thought Felipe's question was really interesting about the tension between globalization and the commonality of music expression across the world. And in the pile of records, I noticed one called Invitation to the Dead.
Yeah.
How did you come across her work? Because I only discovered that record like a few weeks ago, and I looked at it because I liked the cover. So yes, what's your relation to her?
It's actually a guy that made the music, Tomo Akakiwabaya. And the woman on the cover is his muse, and she was a fashion model in the early 80s in Japan. Mm-hmm. And he actually... aside from making the music, he actually sewed the dress that she's wearing. Like, he handmade her dress, which I found so fascinating.
It's really beautiful.
Thanks. But yeah, so he released on his own label called Castle Records in Japan. He released a couple albums. And I had been looking for him for years because I was obsessed with some of those tracks. I was really, really blown away by a lot of it. And he was totally unreachable. I actually thought he had passed away because nobody knew where he was. And then about 2 years ago, I was talking to a friend of mine who's Japanese, and he travels to Tokyo a lot. And he actually knew the engineer for the record. So he got me in contact with Tomo. And the first email that I got from him, which was like in broken English, said that he had been following Minimal Wave on Facebook for years now. Oh. And I was just like, what? Really? So yeah, he already knew the label, and he was like, of course, no problem. You can put out my music. And I have this great photograph of this woman that had never been published by, he's an incredible photographer.
It sounds like synchronicity, not just that record, but I guess the way that all of your, all the records you put out work.
Yeah, definitely. When you write to someone.
That's really cool. Thanks.
Anybody else? There's there at the front.
Hi, how are you?
Hi.
Some of us, or most of us, here, whenever we travel, we try to look for record stores and buy some stuff that we can never get back at home. So do you do that when you're traveling to like a small country or wherever you travel to? Do you do that and, you know, bring back all the things and try to re-release, you know, a new compilation or something like that?
I used to do that a lot more. But I found that now that the internet and Discogs exists, it's really hard to find stuff that's like untapped or unknown, because it's like everybody has researched it to death. So to actually find something that's like a rare value is, I kind of gave up on that unless it's about going to like a massive record fair where there's like, you know, bins and bins of stuff that people actually haven't looked through. Yeah, I went to a record fair a few years ago in the Netherlands in Utrecht, and I came across, there was these sellers that were the sons of the label owners, and they didn't even know what they were selling. They were from France, and they said, oh, we do a jazz label, but this is our father's music from the 80s. And so they had, it was Celluloid Records. And so they had all these rare new wave records for €5 each. They were selling them all for €5 each because they didn't know what they were. And so these kinds of instances, I think, are great. Like, they were like, oh yeah, this garbage that we're selling. Like, they, you know, it was great.
Do you, in that sense then, do you feel that your label and when it started and the work that it's done over a certain period of time is a product of its time? In that you kind of started it before like a Discogs boom or something like that. Do you feel that you were able to do it at your leisure without feeling the need to chase like the internet realm of it, as it were?
Yeah, definitely. I think it'd be really frustrating if I'd started it now. Okay. I think I would go, yeah, I would go nuts like trying to.
You should still start a label now. That's fine. you can still do it. It's fine. Don't let's put you
it's
off.
It's not an archival label. Yeah.
Anyone else?
Can I ask another question? Sure. How did you find Marie?
We actually met a year ago here in Montreal. We were playing a show together, and then we were doing a conversation that was recorded by Anthony, who's right there, for Never Apart. And yeah, before that, a friend of mine who I've released called Silent Servant from Los Angeles, he played me her old record, and he was like, listen to this girl, you're gonna really like her, and like watch her, you know, keep your eye out and stuff. So then we finally met, yeah, exactly a year ago.
And then exactly 1 year later, you're sitting with a record in your hand. That's great. Yeah. As it takes about a year to get a vinyl out anyway, so, you know, it worked. Anybody else?
Actually, I was really curious to know, because you clearly dedicate your life to music. You're a DJ, you have a label, you run actually two, a label and a sub-label. Your partner is a DJ. Where do you find the time to listen to music and appreciate it and judge it and like, you know, like, and what kind of music do you listen at home, like on your free time, if you do?
Well, recently, I mean, it's been like children's music because I have cool. a child at home. So it's been like, yeah, really basic children's music. But I mean, I find there's always time to listen and research. I mean, I just find moments to do it. At home, I mean, I like Italo disco a lot and I listen to that. And I like soundtracks. I mean, stuff that you like, you know, like horror movie soundtracks. And yeah, I mean, there's all kinds of stuff that I like. So most recently, though, it's like with limited time, I really just have been going back into the archives of music that artists that I've already released have sent me, because they really... each of them had sent me so much music. So it's just like investigating the archives I already have. Yeah.
Was there anyone else? There's one up the back. We'll probably just do those last two, so.
Hi. I just wanted to know if you ever worked with the band De.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, De is one of my favorite bands.
Same.
That I released. I have two of their records here. Let's find it. There it is.
There's one there.
Yeah, and the other one is over there. Yeah, they're an incredible band.
Yeah, I know. But I didn't know it existed, like, physical.
Yeah, this is going to be reissued, this record. We have repressed it twice now. So there's already 1,500 copies in circulation, or 1,600 copies, but it needs to be repressed because it's one of our most popular ones.
And who are De? Like, what is the act?
They were lovers, and they sing duets and make really beautiful synth pop music.
Hence the De.
Yeah. Yeah.
You can buy one at a fine music establishment soon.
Doing all this research and archiving music for the last years, do you feel around you, like on these days there's the internet and everyone is able to know everything, and every day there's a new release around the world. So do you feel around you? I feel that, but as a researcher and doing the stuff you do. Do you feel around you people are losing passion on knowing new stuff?
You mean because of the interest in, like, archival stuff?
No, sorry, maybe I was too confused. I mean, like, there's so much thing going being released nowadays, yeah. And every day. So if you feel like... around you, while you were on the last years archiving music and researching every day on a different way, not depending on the internet and on Spotify and stuff like that, do you feel like the people around you, or maybe even you, can lose a little bit of passion because of something like internet and Spotify and iTunes?
You mean because there's like an abundance,
yes.
Too much of saturation?
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's really comes down to your own perspective and how much you let come in. Like, for example, a few weeks ago, I had so many, in my email accounts, I had blasted with all these new releases, like from so many different sources. And I just thought, you know what, I need to unsubscribe to all this stuff, because it's really about what you allow to come in. Because you can get, I mean, yeah, I got totally overwhelmed. That's like, there's just too much music. There's too much new music out there. I can't even keep up. I mean, and then when I'm DJing a lot of new stuff. And of course I'd like to keep, you know, relevant with what's new. So it's just too much. I think it's important to limit that stuff, to just like unsubscribe many,
from
many, many websites, and just like on your own time, if you want to look at like Juno or Boomcat or whatever, just go look at, you know what I mean? Instead of like being bombarded in your email box.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think you have to create your own reality there. Yeah.
Because there was actually a quote on the back of the Oppenheimer analysis record that you pointed out to me earlier. Like, what was that quote, if we could possibly find it?
Yeah,
I think that would be... It actually reminds me kind of that. Mm-hmm. Just, like, choosing your own pace with sound and music. Have it as a hobby and not a job.
Yeah, Martin Lloyd, the quote is, "To my mind, music is always about creating an alternative soundtrack to our real and fantasy lives." Yeah, I really like that.
I think that's a great one to end on. Veronica, thank you so much.
Thank you. Thanks. Thank you.